So, I think we start. Hello, everybody. So we will today talk a little bit about the nodes number 11, which were on protostellar disks and outflow. And I have two small little exercises where we will compute a couple of things related to a disk. And we will start by looking at the torque in a thin disk. And we'll look at how the magnetic field might limit the inner radius so that it can't come closer to the central star. When you recall, the general idea was that we have a star in the center that has magnetic field lines, like here it's a little bit tilted, but a bipolar magnetic field that then of course passes through the disk. Yeah. And since we have differential rotation of the disk, that means different rings in the disk rotate at different angular velocities, and this then automatically will, for example, here when the outer disk rotates faster, will, can we maybe move this in the opposite direction? This will tear the field lines apart because they are coupled to the material, and maybe this is more reasonable. And so this produces a torque between the different rings because, of course, the field lines try to stay together because it changes the magnetic pressure. Also, okay, so the magnetic field lines limit the movement of the inner rings. So the animation here was basically in the wrong direction, but it doesn't matter. And we can estimate a little bit what is the limit on the minimum radius. So, but for that we can look at the total torque that is exerted on, like, the inner parts of this accretion disk by the magnetic field. So this is here the magnetic field strength, so the component perpendicular to the disk. Perpendicular to the disk plane at the surface of the star. R star is the surface radius and R min is the radius of the minimum disk. And when we equate this magnetic torque with the viscosity and the viscous torque of the in the disk, because of course the magnetic field is also rotating due to the rotation of the star, so we have two different rotations. When we equate this, we can derive an expression for the inner radius of the accretion disk, which is truncated by the stellar magnetic field. And the inner radius and the radius of the central star are related by this relation, depending on the accretion rate m dot. And capital M is, well, this should be actually capital M here. No capital M. And when we put in some typical numbers, so one solar mass for the star, one solar radius, which is a little bit small, and an magnetic field of 0.1 Tesla and a relatively low accretion rate here, we can compute the ratio between as 50 times the stellar radius times here all the factors of our parameters. So putting in the numbers gives us 13 stellar radii, or solar radii here in this particular case. And we see here that this has a negative exponent for the accretion rate. So when we increase the accretion rate, the expression goes down, and there's a typical class of young stars, a few Orionis stars. Orionis because it is a star in the Orion constellation, and which has an extreme strong phase, kind of an outburst in accretion rate, a sudden increase in luminosity by many orders of magnitude, which is related to the star suddenly accreting like factor of a few thousand, maybe 10,000 more mass than typically. So when we put in this, what we get is a ratio here of the disk radius to the stellar radius, which is basically unity, which means that in this case the magnetic field lines is basically carried by the accreted material back to the surface of the star. So the inner disk is approaching the star and pressing the magnetic field lines at the stellar surface, so to speak. So this is just a very brief quantitative example. And in a second example, we will look again at T Tauri stars. We will meet them again in the protostellar evolution section in the lecture notes. And we will here just construct a simple model of such a T Tauri disk in terms of some parameters: the density in the midplane, the temperature in the midplane, and the surface temperature. So we have a disk that has a certain thickness, and it will have a temperature gradient between the center and the surface, and also a density gradient. It will have an angular velocity that we consider here constant for the relevant portions. And we assume that it is nevertheless pretty thin and optically thick. Optically thick automatically means, and this has then consequences also for the thermal equilibrium, and we will assume that the whole thing is in thermal and mechanical equilibrium, just to make the whole computation easier. Okay, let's assume that this disk, because it has a certain temperature at the surface, radiates this energy away as a black body. And we would like to show that the temperature at the surface and the temperature at the midplane are related to each other by this relation, which is a function of this disk surface density. Disk surface density, actually the column density, also Oberflächendichte, yes. And the opacity, okay. Good. So we assumed that the disk is optically thick, which means radiation cannot just leave the center of the disk, but it has basically to diffuse out. And in this case, the radiation flux is given by this diffusion approximation here, where we have the radiation energy density, or to be more precise, the gradient of the radiation energy density in vertical direction, and these prefactors here. And assuming a certain gas temperature, we can express the radiation energy density with the Stefan-Boltzmann law, which is a function of temperature to the power of 4 and some prefactors. So we saw this last week, I think, or the week before. So this here is the prefactor for the Stefan-Boltzmann law, which just states that the total energy density radiated by a black body per square centimeter is so integrated over all frequencies is the Stefan-Boltzmann constant times the temperature to the power of 4. And A here contains the Stefan-Boltzmann constant plus some factor that accounts for optical properties that deviate from a pure black body. And this is, yeah, so inserting this, what we finally get is here that the flux depends on the vertical gradient of t to the 4 and this this 4 factor. And I'm somewhat unsure about the prefactor 4. Let's assume that this is correct for the moment. Okay, maybe it's a typo. It doesn't matter, it's just a factor 4. Okay, so we have this for the flux. And when we now have thermal equilibrium, then this means that we also have a constant flux, because if the flux changes, this would also then change the temperature conditions, which automatically means that the flux doesn't vary with height within the disk. And when we integrate now so when we put the density on the left-hand side and integrate from the center of our disk to the surface, we find this expression here. So from thermal equilibrium, we concluded that F is not a function of C. And we can here then just integrate the density from the center to the surface, which gives us sigma half, because sigma goes basically through the whole disk and we are just integrating from the center to the surface. And we have here as a result this integral. So the flux depends on the midplane temperature, when we just assume that the temperature is at the surface is much smaller. Which is reasonable in any optical thick disk. So it will be warmer in the inside than in the outside. Okay. So this is, okay, here we assume that we just radiate away energy in the top direction. Okay. Now this flux needs to be the same as the flux that's being radiated away by the surface. So we can approximately equate this. So this is the flux that's diffusing from the center to the surface, and this is the energy, the radiation flux that's leaving the surface, that needs to be the same. And when we solve this for the mid-plane temperature, we get here this clear relation how the temperature in the center and how the temperature at the surface need to be related to each other, just because of the basically the rate at which energy can leave the center of our disk. Okay. So we keep this in mind, we use this later. We will now look at again at the disk and assume that the viscosity within the disk can be described with the parameter alpha, and then here the sound speed and the disk height or the scale height. And for such a disk, when we look at the energy rate per unit area of the disk, so the rate at which this energy can be is released by dissipation, so basically the friction heating produced produced energy is given by the viscosity times the surface density and of course the angular velocity, and with this four factor here. So we can now also try to express the mid-plane temperature in terms of these overall properties of the disk, because when we relate this, so we argued in the beginning or assumed that we have mechanical equilibrium, mechanical and thermal equilibrium. So this energy here that is released due to the friction, due to viscous effects in the disk itself, needs to be radiated away, of course. So it contributes to the surface temperature. So we equate this again. We can compute the surface temperature now in terms of viscosity, surface density, and the angular velocity, and can then plug in this temperature here in our expression to conclude the mid-plane temperature that this produces, and finally get here to this expression where we also substitute the sound speed just with the mid-plane temperature and the Boltzmann constant and the mean particle mass. Okay. Gut. So even though we started by this, of course the majority of the friction is of course taking place in the center plane where the densities are much higher. No? Good. So just the rotation of the speed, the friction actually heats the disk. The heating then leads to the radiation of the disk that we can observe. This produces a certain surface temperature and so on. We can, when we look at the energy production rate and compare it with the total energies involved, we can compute cooling times and then get an idea how the thermodynamical behavior is. Is it isothermal? Is it adiabatic or so? So the cooling time is the thermal energy, the total thermal energy divided by the rate at which energy is radiated away. So the thermal energy per unit area depends on the surface density and this is nonsense here. The sound speed squared. And divided by gamma, which is the ratio of the specific heats for the gas. You know, this is then either 5/3 or 7/5, depending on the properties of the gas. Is it monoatomic? Is it diatomic? Has it rotational or vibrational or electronic energies available? And the rate at which radiation is radiated away is again given by the Boltzmann law, Stefan Boltzmann law, times 2, because we have a surface at the top and we have a surface at the bottom. So the cooling time consequently is the ratio between the two. And we can insert here our expression for the thermal energy. And then what do we do here? Replace the surface temperature, which what we derived for the mid-plane temperature. And Tm, mid-plane surface, power of 3. Okay. And this is approximately this expression. And when we now divide this by the orbital period, so the time for one revolution here, then this is 2 pi over omega, of course. So the omega cancels out. And we have the ratio between the two, we have here this ratio between the two, which is, so this is basically given. So this only now depends by the alpha. And the alpha is somewhat uncertain. Let's assume that it is in the order of 0.01 or smaller. Then this number is clearly larger than 1, which means that it takes much longer for the disk to cool than compared to the orbital period. So, which means that while the disk rotates, we have little cooling. It remains basically, it behaves adiabatically, because the friction produces energy much faster than the whole disk can basically get rid of the energy, and this is our definition of, or this is the adiabatic case. If the cooling time was much shorter, then every time energy is generated by this friction, it would be immediately released by radiation and the temperature would remain constant. So only for very large values of alpha, we will then move on to adiabatic situation, to isothermal situations. Okay, so let's look at the last one. What did I do here? So when we now look at the disk with a certain mass, let's say 3% of the solar mass, we have a 1 solar mass star. And we have a certain square centimeter. This is actually, that should be an absorption coefficient here. and a certain value of alpha, and a disk that spans from 1 to 20 astronomical units, then we now want to express this disk in units of the quantities that we discussed in the sections above. So let's look at the surface density. This should vary inversely with the radius. So we can parameterize that the surface density as a function of the radius or the relative radius to the power of minus 1 and some reference surface density as here, for example, R0. Then we can compute the disk mass by integrating this from the inner to the outer radius. And this gives here this expression. And we can rearrange this to derive the sigma naught. And then multiplied with this, we have an expression for our surface density as a function of radius. And the density is, the surface density then is 2,200 gram per cubic centimeter times r to the power of minus 1. When we have one solar mass for the star, and m disk was given here, actually, m disk is given, the orbital period for a certain star of the disk is given by this expression. So we can, of course, immediately write this down here. And we had the expression for the midplane temperature as function of the surface temperature and the omega here and some kappa values and alpha. When we plug this in, here we can write down the midplane temperature as this. So maybe I'm curious how this looks like. Okay, plot range all maybe log. So we have at a radius of 1,000 Kelvin, and we go down to a few 10 Kelvin at 20 astronomical units. So that's the temperature in the midplane for our disk. And of course, we can also put in here then the surface temperature as a comparison, which we computed also above, minus 11 divided by 12. Maybe minus here. Okay, so and this is the surface temperature, which has a somewhat different slope. And, well, the disk cools down to maybe, 20 Kelvin or something at 20 AU. Good. The midplane density is approximately the surface density divided by the thickness of the disk. And we can express the thickness again with here the sound speed and the rotation speed, which means we can write down the density approximately like this. This is a somewhat steeper density law. Let's briefly look at that. To the minus 9. And where this goes down by approximately one order of magnitude, we have here a reduction from a few 10 to the minus 9 to a few 10 to the minus 12 here, so significantly steeper. The densities, let's see if we want to have this in particle densities, because this is in gram. We need something like the we have to divide this by the proton mass, which is 7, 10 to the minus 24 about. So we have particle densities in the center of 10 to the 15 particles per cubic centimeter, and at further distances 10 to the 12. So still reasonably dense gas in the disk. And we can then also compute the Q parameter, so this Toombra parameter that indicates whether we have stability or instability against gravitational perturbations. And this goes down also with radius and is still significantly larger than one. So in this particular numerical case, we have a stable disk. Good, so this is all pretty much hand waving, but gives us some idea on the structure of this disk, what are typical temperatures, densities, and so on. Okay, so do you have any questions here on this? I'm pretty sure there are a couple of typos. I have to check this. But qualitatively, this should be all okay.